Don't be nervous.
We're going to kick out from seven since last time I played in Richmond.
This is going to be the heckler right here. I just want to put out the problem child right here.
Do you guys...
Feel, we give you our love and support, and we're going to do the best we can.
You got
to
be the one.
To shut down the heckler.
Turn that off right before I... No, is there a light? Is that... Does that beautiful thing work?
Whoop.
Sorry.
Yeah. That's like... a work of art.
I'll just turn this guy off for a moment.
Yeah, that'd be good, because... by me. Oh. Yeah, so I played in Williamsburg last night for a little group of people.
A house show in Williamsburg? Where was it?
It was right near what do they call it? Downtown.
On in Williamsburg?
Yeah.
I was like, why would you put your guy
in friends of mine that own a chocolate
Danger.
Shop. Artist that moved down here from Annapolis that got into business.
They have a chocolate shop in CW in Clinton, Illinois.
It's called Killman's.
Huh.
Right
by, I'm from Williamsburg.
It's right by Roma's. You know where that is?
Yep.
I'm guessing it's Italian, though.
Yeah.
What?
I'm guessing it's an Italian.
Oh, well, I mean, that's it.
Yeah.
Oh, Roma's, right, the right. Coffee shop. Yeah, I know where you're talking about. It's
right
across from, like, Blue Talon Bistro. Yeah,
I'm
yeah,
yeah.
Oh, so. Something keep you moved.
Oh, they had me over.
I was drinking that one, Daniel.
You know, you had
that,
you,
that one.
That one?
Yep.
Alright. I just changed
well,
these.
I fed the animals, ate a little bit. It's not much. Played Fallout 4 for about an hour.
Is it cold that we
can get?
We just need Wayne Milton here.
I mean,
still got all
yeah.
No, no more ducks.
Wait, where's he living? Probably LA or something.
I lost track of him when he moved to LA.
Yeah.
We had a,
LA has a way of doing
we
it.
Had a falling out before he moved.
Oh no.
Because he perceived
it was over
that I was down. Using him to have featured articles in Style Magazine.
Oh.
Yeah, Scott kicked him out of the Football Fantasy League.
That's just me.
Did I?
No. He stayed in until the end of the year, but he didn't come back.
It's only probably because he wasn't active. Sound check here.
10 years.
What were you talking about?
The football league.
I created my
oh,
email
yeah.
account that year when he invited me, and it was called Drewart 2003. That was the year I started. That was my first email.
What's that?
Woo! That was.
Two.
I was back when I could make the joke. Like, hey, have you guys heard about this email thing?
Is that too loud, Daniel?
Like,
I mean, I'll probably sing pretty
well, like,
loud. And if I get too loud, just give me a little, like, don't do
that. Electronically?
I'll sound off in my feelings.
Like, you
beat
them?
Yeah,
we do that joke back there.
Thumbs down to you, Crowder.
I guess it's good.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me get my book out. I wrote down all the songs that I've recorded over the years, and I was like, oh, that's daunting. Like, I'm not Mick and Keith, I don't remember all these, so I've got chord sheets and stuff, like I'm an old person. Because that's punk, you know, no one does that.
But you can still read it without reading glasses.
So that's not punk.
That's...
I saw Marion Faithful at the Wolf Trap.
Uh-huh.
Is that the place in Northern Virginia with
the
seats?
Yeah, with the lawn and the... Yeah.
No. Oh. So there's another place that's got seats. It's indoors. It's weird.
Oh, it's like the theater?
It feels like Oktoberfest
like
in Busch Gardens. It's weird. Yeah, it's dinner
like
theater.
Built?
Something like that. Something, yeah. It's kind of high class.
Yeah.
And Kevin Cornell and I went. We saw Marion Faithful.
Oh, wow.
And she had her reading glasses out and song sheets. And I thought, okay, she's giving me. You know what I'm talking about?
Marion Faithful?
Yeah. I shook her hand. It was like soft as velvet. It's disturbing. But, well, and then she did that weird movie. You don't know what I'm talking about.
You don't.
Leave it there. It was a
leave it. Leave it there. All right.
You. Do we want to turn this on and that off? How do we want to do it? I'm good like this.
Okay.
It's your home.
All right, cool.
You can turn the stereo lights on so it looks like that's part of my setup. Well, thanks for coming, everybody. This is something I felt like I needed to do this year. And Nate and I were talking about dreams and, you know, ways that you recognize who you are. And maybe those are like, you know, for me, like fifth grade was a big year for me. Like when I competed against others in my class and like running and it, like we had like gangs and we discovered breakdancing. My breakdance name was Tidal Wave. And so, but you know, for years I'd associate myself as being something to do with that. And we still do that, you know, as adults. We like associate ourselves with different eras maybe that formed us. And music has always been that for me. So I wanted to be in people's living rooms in this crazy world that we live in now where conversation is kind of less regarded in the busyness of life. And I just want to like provoke this conversation and through song and me doing a little chit chat. So you guys kind of see the evolved Scott Crowder, a little less sarcastic and mean. a little less. Come on. So I made a couple records since I've been in Richmond, and one of them is called Upon Shoulders, so I'm going to sing a couple songs from that right now. And where will I go? Let's see, I didn't write a set list. I'm going to do this one first. It's called In the Sunrise, and it's a song, Jackson, you can write it with my kids in mind. I've got a 12-year-old. Girl, how old are you, Jackson?
12.
I thought so. I remember when Jackson was born. I remember when your dad told me that you were on your way. You remember that? We were at the bar over here, the pool tables. I said, oh man, here it comes. I spelled the change.
Let me get my prompts out just in case I have a senior moment. I'm a cheat. Basically, what happened to me is playing in churches so much, you use all these chord sheets, and it's like your brain on GPS. You stop remembering. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
You're like, what's happened to me? So, I messed this song up last night, so let's make sure.
Like I always say, always remember to never forget.
But here's what's going to, yeah, that's true. And here's what's going to happen. Maybe I'll inspire another level of authenticity through my mistakes. All right.
2-8. Is that good, Daniel? You fine? Yeah? This is In the Sunrise.
Left behind is just shadows. It's you and me in the sunrise. And call a fool, cause I won't pretend that hope is lost, that this is the end. The light of life is the love in your eyes. That is what we do. Matters what we say, matters how we live out the days of our lives. Making all things new is meaning here today. All the earth moves into the sunrise. off in the living room, not buying into the doom and gloom. Spend my days on my kids living long lives. Cause there's a thief, but I won't be cold. I'll weep with those who weep. Look out, darkness, you can't hide the sunrise. Matters what we do, matters what we say, matters how we live out the days of our lives. Making all things new, there's meaning here today. All the earth moves into the light of the sunrise. That is what we do, that is what we say, that is how we live.
Line in there about my kids and not being caught up in the doom and gloom and thinking about my kids having a long life. And I realized in myself that I was like kind of banking on the world coming to an end and not really having a plan for my future. And not having a plan for being like a grandfather and my kids like continuing on. Hopefulness, and so that song's kind of like a challenge to the notion that everything's getting worse, and that like what we do does matter, and like there like something's in the details of how we treat each other that shows us the value of life. So that's a bit of what that song's about. So yeah, and it's called In the Sunrise because I make this line. He's good. Like, does the sun rise, or does the earth move into the light of the sunrise? Like, sometimes we think, like, oh, if only something good would come my way again, and we think it's just all crap, possibly. But the reality is, the earth is turning into a sun that's always shining. So, I know it's my belief that there is always good possibilities that are just around the corner. And it's just a matter of like maybe going through the storm. A woman that I knew her son, her husband died suddenly. It was a tragic event, and she was a preacher, and my wife heard her say that. I didn't hear her say it. She said she was talking about the whole thing, and she said this kind of throwaway line, but it's super profound. She said sometimes the things that you're going through are just the things you're going through. I thought, oh, that's actually got a lot of weight to it when you think about tragedy and how it disrupts everything that you hold true. Sometimes what you're going through, crisis, is just something you're going through, and there's light at the end of the tunnel. So that's good what that song is. Here's another one from the uncritically acclaimed, because I never send out any reviews for any, never send out any of my CDs.
Because you are nice to wait.
Because what?
Because you are nice.
I weren't nice, yeah. Well, so the Foolish Beauty record I did, the Dark Room stuff, the EP, first EP we did in like 2003, it's like a life ago. I didn't, you know, I was like, how do you get a review? You feel like you're begging and you don't have a publicist. You feel like slime. Like, can you please review my record? I sent it to you. You said you got it. You said you liked it, you know. Like, there's a Pitchfork writer in Richmond, Mark Richardson.
He's no longer in Richmond, but yeah.
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 And I remember finding that out, and he's like, yeah, put it in my mail. And I put it in a aluminum foil, and I like did weird stuff to it, like, you know, to try to get attention. Nothing, you know. Like, and like one year I tried to get in CMJ when that was a thing, no longer a thing. And Dan, you might have been with me. Were you with me? Yeah. Daniel took Polaroids of me at Hollywood Cemetery, and we found gravestones that said Scott. And I'd sit in front of the gravestones, and we painted them weird pictures. And I sprayed Dracar on all the photos. So that when you open the envelope, it would, like, you would never forget. You would never forget that envelope. You know, you're seeking attention, you know, so to, like, somehow make someone pause and go, that's the weirdest envelope in this whole pile. You have to throw that CD in, you know? Because it's often not that you suck and someone else is great. It's often no one just looks your way, you know, so you want someone just to pause and look your way and consider you, because there's certainly, like, worse art out there that is super famous, you know. So anyway, I didn't send out any reviews for Upon Shoulders. I'm just too tired. I have three kids, man. So I'm going to do another song. This is called When the Sun Disappears, and it kind of goes into that theme of what In the Sunrise is a little bit, this idea that when the sun goes down, maybe, like, it's bad, but maybe, just maybe, something good's around the corner, so. Vibe good or anything?
Disappears. All of us here.
So, I wanted to
share a couple quotes. I'm doing a lot of reading, and just been trying. I found out through like some of the corporation stuff that you do when you get a real job, and they you find out like what your strengths are and what your weaknesses are and what kind of person you are. Just it's not something to bank on, but sometimes it's framework for understanding yourself. And one of the things I found out, this would be helpful for our past interactions have been, is in Myers-Briggs. Anybody familiar with Myers-Briggs stuff? I'm an ENTP, which means I'm a debater. So it's like, oh, that's why I was like a jerk to half my friends growing up. And that's why like the teachers would like, stop talking back, you know? It's because like, I'm always after the why of any event. And you guys know, it's my day job. I'm a pastor. It's like what I do. I'm a pastor for a local church. So in that way, Nate knows me through that. Like, I'm always like, guys, if anybody's asked why we're doing this, it's me. You know, like, I'm always like at the core of like, what are we freaking doing? So here's a quote in this book called If You Want to Write. And writing is something I've been starting to do, like literature and all that. And this lady wrote 9 million words in her life. This was written in the 30s. Her name's Brenda Uhland. And this is a classic, evidently, about how to write. And like authors and aspiring writers would read this. But she's talking about the things that inspire us and why you would write. Why would you create anything? Why would you like make something and share it? You know, even like at crafts in camp, why you would make something and actually bring it to your mom. You know, like it's that core value of why we create. So this is what she says about Vincent Van Gogh. This is just was really profound to me. She said, if you read the letters of the painter Van Gogh, you will see what his creative impulse was. It was just this. He loved something. The sky, say. He loved human beings. He wanted to show human beings how beautiful the sky was. So he painted it for them. And that was all there was to it. When Van Gogh was a young man in his early 20s, he was in London studying to be a clergyman. He had no thought of being an artist at all. He sat in his cheap little room, writing a letter to his younger brother in Holland, whom he loved very much. He looked out his window at a watery twilight, a thin lamppost, a star. And he said in his letter something like this, "It's so beautiful. I must show you how it looks." And then, on his cheap ruled notepaper, he made the most beautiful, tender little drawing of it. When I read this letter of Van Gogh's, it comforted me very much, and it seemed to throw clear light on the whole road of art, capital A. Before, I had thought that to produce a work of painting or literature, you scowled and thought long and ponderously and weighed everything solemnly and learned everything that all artists had ever done aforetime and what their influences and schools were, and you were extremely careful about design and balance and getting interesting planes into your painting and avoided with most stringent severity showing the faintest academical tendency and were strictly modern and so on and so on. And I'll just insert here, part of why I moved to Richmond was to like learn about music. I wanted to play music, so I was like, okay, I need to be a part of a culture like Newport News that has music seen. You can actually see it because it's seen, it's visible. So I identified with that. She says, but the moment I read Van Gogh's letter, I knew what art was and the creative impulse. It's a feeling of love and enthusiasm for something. And in a direct, simple, passionate, and true way, you try to show this beauty in things to others by drawing it. The difference between Van Gogh and you and me is that while we may look at the sky and think it's beautiful, we don't go so far as to show someone else how it looks. One reason may be that we don't care enough about the sky or for other people. But most often I think it's because we've been sky is not important. Breathing pretty chewy there. So I just want to like provoke us to think, and I have been changed since you guys knew me, in the sense that like some of it's fatherhood, some of it's moving back to a city that I so desperately wanted to escape, and realizing that life is what you make it, and like I want to see things become beautiful, because I know that like if we're here and we have anything to do with each other, it's to somehow receive each other with honor and say like, okay, you're valuable, I want to spend time with you, you know, or Richmond, this is an interesting city, I'm going to spend my days here, you know. Anyway, so with that, I'm going to share a Bob Dylan song about something that he thought was beautiful. And maybe you guys know this song, maybe you don't, but it's called Lenny Bruce. Anybody know that song? Okay. This is a fun song. And I did it last night and shocked a couple people. In a fun way. Alright, let's see here. Okay. Daniel, you know this song? You know, I didn't have my guitar on at all. It sounded pretty fine. I plugged in. One, two. Which one is it? I don't know. It's good enough there, right? File this with Brenda's statement about finding things beautiful or people beautiful or valuable. As Bob Dylan sings about a dead comedian.
Lenny Bruce is dead, but his ghost lives on and on. Never did get any gold. Seemed like it took a couple of months. They said that he was sick, 'cause he didn't play by the rules. He just showed all the wise men of his day to be nothing more than a bunch of fools. They stamped him and they labeled him like they do with pants and shirts. Fought a war on a battlefield where every victory hurts. Lenny Bruce was bad. He was the brother you never had.
Thank you. I love that song, man. Everything from the uncomfortable line about cutting off babies' heads to Daniel and I were just in passing, talking about satire and the power of satire to point at lies and say that's not true. Like, Simpsons have been doing it for 20 plus years, you know, funny cartoons that point out the ridiculousness of things. And,
not appropriate, Scott.
It's what?
Not appropriate.
It's not appropriate? Oh, yeah. That's what scared mothers say of people maybe looking into things that are a little bit messy. And that's why I like this, like this song about Bob Dylan that he wrote about Lenny Bruce. Like, Lenny Bruce was so offensive in his day. You know, like, they would, like, people would, he'd be arrested for the things that are pretty commonplace now. And I did hear, and I will add, that his daughter, in response to this song, said Bob Dylan got one part wrong for sure. He did actually want to continue living. It's like his life just ended too soon. It wasn't that he didn't like life. But, I mean, any comments about that song or anything being suggested or talked about, I'm open to that. Like, this is the cool thing about doing a house show. If you have something, you could just do it.
I like how Bob Dylan is like, he doesn't, like, he uses metaphor, but he'd rather use straight words to tell you what he's thinking instead of just filling a song with metaphor. And I like that.
Oh, that's good. Stuff. Maybe that's why he's regarded as one of the greatest living songwriters, because he can do both.
Right.
But he does, he just tells you. Like that line about, I mean, just the last line is almost my favorite line. Lenny Bruce was bad. He's the brother you never had. And then in that moment, I'm always like, that's right. Like, I don't have a brother like that, but I always wanted a brother like that. That takes the heat for you. That, you know, pushes the boundaries a little bit. Yeah, that's good. And I was thinking of this song coming over here, and I was thinking of sharing that for me, that person, if there is a person in my life, my uncle was certainly kind of like that, did some inappropriate things. Like, I remember, I'll just share this with you guys for the sake of authenticity. I was like Jackson's age, 12, and he'd say, hey, you want to go out and get some, you know, Slurpees or pretzels? You know, what was ever appropriate for a kid? Yeah, let's go do that. So we drive out, it's like 8, 9 o'clock at night, and he would go to a strip bar, and I'd sit in the parking lot, like for an hour to 2 hours listening to the music, not really understanding how inappropriate that whole thing was. Not only is he at a stripper bar, but he's left a kid
in the parking lot
of, like, be off the beaten path, you know, like, who knows what's going down in that parking lot. And that was that's something. But for me, the person that kind of represents.
Wait, was that Uncle Johnny?
Yeah, which stripper bar?
You guys know? Huh? Which stripper bar? It was the Cat in Newport News.
No, but was it Johnny?
No, Johnny wouldn't do that.
Okay.
It was my Uncle David. This isn't being recorded. Well, I might have to edit that out.
This is being recorded.
Is that recorded?
You want me to edit this out? Man.
Well, we're not divulging last names.
Well, released this posthumously.
I didn't want to do any extra work on this
report. <Really? laughs> But, you know, in the name of this, like, my dad probably is that person that is, in some ways, represents the safest wild person in my life. You know what I mean? Like, my dad, whenever he does pass, that will be something I will lose forever, is that, like, my dad still, to this day, pushes the envelope with me. And he was a pastor for 20-plus years, so that's just fun to think about. But, like, he, Daniel can testify, he breaks that mold. I won't tell any stories about that, since this is being recorded. Awesome. So, all right. Let me see what else I'm going to share. All right. I'm gonna try another song, but I'm gonna move to the piano. And this song is a song I started in Richmond when I was technically still in Dark Little Rooms, although I identified with that after I moved. But it was a song I was really, speaking of dreams, I was really excited about this song and working it with Kevin and Ian, who are in the band, and it lasted as an idea for probably like 8 years.
Wow.
And then finally I landed it, and it's called Who Knows Why, and I'm gonna share it with you right now. Who Knows Why. Kevin was supposed to come. His girlfriend got sick, he said. I've heard that before.
The only female in this room.
The only female.
Alright, okay, I'll let this stuff out. Just let me know and I'll go over and look at the time.
So where is this going? Huh? I don't know if anybody's gonna watch this, but.
No, it's going on YouTube. But no, I'll just, after I'm done, you know, if you mention, can I edit something out, I'll go look at the time on there, take a note, and then
What is that? What'd you say?
I never heard someone refer to them as stripper bars.
Really?
What we call them?
It's a strip club.
Strip club. Yeah, I don't know why I said it that way. Yeah, stripper bar. I don't know if I've ever said that before.
It's a dancing establishment.
A dancing establishment. That's like when you meet some of these fine ladies, and you know, you ask their name, and you get their professional name, right? Charmaine. Star. Anyway, we're off the course now. Alright, this song is called Who Knows Why.
Maybe
it's appropriate titles for the moment. Alright.
Dream, all I want.
First Dark Lord Room's EP was called Loser's Game, and then the next record was called Foolish Beauty. So there's like a little play on even my own efforts, like some little self-deprecation in there of like putting my hopes and dreams into music in Richmond. It's the Loser's Game. And then when I made the next record, spending all my days as an account executive in Wilmington, North Carolina, with a baby. And still wanting to be a musician, I was making Foolish Beauty. That was where that came from. So I'm going to attempt to sing Loser's Game now, the classic that was played a long time ago, University of Richmond Radio. That was fun. Loser's Game. And you know, it's probably messing me up. Like Michael Scott when he had GPS and he almost turned into the lake in the office. using these... these chords over here, but it's like my safety valve.
Thank you.
Valley Cats. So, you guys heard that one. I was like, back in the day.
Yeah. Back in the day. I did.
I came out of Elvin Thompson's lunch, and I got my big white van. My big, remember that van I had? Big white van. And that was on the radio. That was one of the best moments ever. It just really was. And back to that line in Lenny Bruce, when Bob Dylan says, I rode with him in a taxi.
Chris Brooks was playing it, right?
No, that was different. Okay. This was just University of Richmond. I don't even know. It was like getting on the phone immediately. How'd they get this? Oh my gosh, it's so cool. Small potatoes, right? But it was something that never happened for me before. And so like that Lenny Bruce line where Bob Dylan says, I rode with him in a taxi once. It's just a mile and a half. Seemed like it took a couple of months. Like sometimes time freezes in those moments. And that was like a frozen moment where I just sat and like listened to it. And of course, you know, the critical ear comes out. How's this sound on the radio? Like, what are they going to say next? You know, I remember calling in and requesting my own song. What were they saying?
Hey, could you play that Dark Little Room song? God given.
Yeah, I remember once it was like the DJ had never heard it. You know, he like did the request and he put it in and he heard the song God Given, and he was like, wow. Like that was good. I was like, fire. But it was, you know, what does that equate to in today's world? Getting a like on Facebook. You know, that's what it was. But it felt so good. So Loser's Game, that really is about my musical aspirations and like putting so much of myself. I mean, I moved to this city to do music. That's the truth of it. And I left the city feeling like music was over for me, and that was like deep pain. But this chorus line, Mary said I want it all. I don't know, like, well, Mary is my mom's name, but it really wasn't about her. It was just kind of the provocation that maybe my mom saying you're selfish with what you're trying to do in your life. And it's all about you. And Mary saying I want it all. I just need a place to call. I never tried to run away. Just needed time and the world would change. I don't know if I wrote it with this meaning, but when I sing it now, I think about that line, I needed time and the world to change. I think about that quite a bit, actually. It's like back to my first song. Sometimes we can live thinking everything becoming better is on everybody else's shoulders. Like, if they would just pull it together, we could get this thing back on track. And that's kind of what that line is, a little bit like that, like looking elsewhere for the excuse of why you're maybe not successful. I need some time, and you guys just understood how good this is, you know? Like someone could just see, right? So that's where it's coming from. So that's that song, and it always hurt me so bad that this would get, I think it was this part that reminded people of Coldplay at the time. I've never even listened to a whole Coldplay song, but something about that, I think, is the Coldplay thing. Or maybe it's the singing. What do you guys think? What was it?
Not the singing. Because I listened to Coldplay pretty early on, because I worked with an Atlantic Records.
There you go. What, is there anything in that song that's Coldplay?
It's the piano, slightly.
Like it doesn't sound like a song, but it sounds like a song.
Maybe it was the era, and it was like a little bit emotional rock or something.
There was another band that they were promoting alongside with Coldplay at the same time, and
Stella Star?
No.
No.
But I can hear more of that about. Mm.
I mean, this is what I hear. You know, like when you make a picture, or you know, what do you do? You have a medium, right? Was it you're a painter?
I'm a medium. Yeah.
You're a medium. You're a painter.
I draw.
Yeah, you draw. You're really good. And I remember. So, what? That's so you always think of yourself. Like I think of influences, and this reminds me of that. When I'm just thinking you might have that in yourself too, maybe.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, yeah.
So when I do this part, and I wasn't trying to do it, but I always think of like Tom York singing the bends. Like, oh yeah, that's kind of in there. There's no one touching him in the bends, but that's fun to think about. Josh Dudley. Any requests at this point? You seem to have some. I was actually not a request, but I was.
You actually had me curious. Can't remember on the Foolish Beauty record. Was any of that recorded with the band, or was that just all
none of it?
Solo?
It was all me.
Okay. I thought maybe some of it you'd like demo with the band or something, and you.
Some of it was demoed with the band.
Yeah.
And there was just things we couldn't figure out, and then. Just time. And I recorded that on my 8-track, reel to reel. And I got the illustrious Jeff Lipton to master it in Boston, who does all the Numero Group label stuff. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that. It's a really cool label. That
right. Well, you did Tom Waits yesterday, so how about Downtown Train Tom Waits?
Oh man, I used to do that song. I'm not up to doing that right now, Josh.
I'll take a request, but we're not going to accept the request. Just hear the request.
I can pull it up on the internet and give it a go.
I was trying to figure out what would be a softball. You know?
What would be a softball?
Yeah.
Downtown Train. Well,
or a
isn't that
maybe.
This wasn't even plugged in. What'd you say?
A curveball. Maybe.
A curveball. I know. Isn't it? There's. I could like, do it. Some of the pros do and. Fake it and see, you know, how laugh at me, how bad it sounds.
Do you know any Coldplay?
Okay, my least favorite song, Coldplay song, would be Yellow, though. That's probably
yeah,
what everybody
yeah,
knows.
That
but
was
like, please
song.
Don't play Yellow.
That's horrible, horrible song.
Any other song of theirs, but
well,
that.
Can you pull out some Buckley? I know you could do that.
Oh my gosh.
Oh man.
I used to attempt that all the time, so I'm just gonna let you do it, Josh.
I don't think I've ever heard you try it.
So. Oh gosh, I don't know if that's healthy, but I would try it. You'll have to. I'll need to like put a like if I'm doing a house show, I have to put like okay, what requests would you like ahead of time, and then from that place.
You gotta cut it.
What?
Yeah, like parse through it. And
that's
like,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
What requests and put on a menu?
Yeah, that's right. You select
what
chicken or shrimp.
ABC.
What chicken or fish?
Well,
which requests?
Well, what were you thinking of?
Oh, I don't know. Where's my? I'll do another cover if you want. We'll just pick it. It'll sound feel like a request. Didn't you want to hear me play? From Gillian Welch, didn't you want to hear that?
That's what he just said.
Did you?
No, I'm kidding.
No.
He's like, Gillian,
you hate her?
I was like, Ludacris or Gillian Welch?
All right, I should do it then. I'll just be in the spirit of sharing. So here's a thing you guys might not know I did.
That's a lot.
In 2010, I quit my big job that moved my family down to North Carolina. To go to a music school out in California, and when I came back, it was like we're gonna dream again, and that is a bit how I got to doing the church thing, which is a wild story. But part of what I started doing was playing in front of like grocery stores and stuff. I mean, it's busking. That's what it was. But Newport News, it's weird. It's really strange down there. And while doing that, I felt like, I mean, it was like some of the most fulfilling music I've ever done because people were so appreciative and you'd get instant connection or instant dislike so you could at least rest. And people would come up, hey man, yeah, let me sing with you, you know, or like this really cool European woman would come up and go, how do you make me feel like I'm in Germany again, you know, and you're like, thank you. I can rest my head. Alright. So this is a Gillian Welch song for a band. It's dedicated. Oh, I could have tuned that.
troubles if you go my way. I am no mother, no father, no sister, no brother. I am an orphan girl. I have had friendships pure and golden, but the ties of kinship I had not known. Thank you.